1, 2, 3, 4.
Heard the one about the drummer who had to fly separately from Oasis because they thought he was bad luck.
Or the one about the drummer whose drum stool caught fire. Or the one about the drummer who crapped himself in Belfast docks.
This is Spike Webb, a UK-based drummer, author, and author of Drummers. I ran into Spike's channel last year as I was developing Drum Recovery Network. What struck me about his content first was the historic names he was able to corral and sit down with to share their stories. Not just any historic drummers, mind you, but the exact handful of drummers that I was having the most difficulty with reaching out to. These specific masters included Topper Heaton from The Clash.
No, it's just a complete.
Kenny Jones from The Who.
They're holding their guitars like this, almost like guns, as if they're waiting to storm the stage again. Yeah,
Nick Mason of Pink Floyd.
Magic came, finally plucked up the courage to come into the studio to talk.
Mel Gaynor from Simple Minds.
Stand up and get the audience participation. My roadie.
He usually. Yeah. Gilson Lavis from Squeeze.
I suppose drumming in a way helps in a therapeutic sense, doesn't it? So that it gets
John Moss from Culture Club.
Led Zeppelin when we were on tour, so.
It
wasn't Led Zeppelin. But it was in a sort of feminine.
Bob Henrit from The Kinks.
Coming from the 50s as a drummer is that we never knew how to do it. There weren't any rules.
Rick Buckler from The Jam.
Do this all of a sudden. And then you get this panicky feeling, you think, and then all of a sudden you sort of.
And Derek McKenzie from Jamiroquai.
Where I've forgotten bits of music.
Yeah,
literally.
It's not like I needed to know his secret magic. That's not giving Spike his proper respect. It's obvious that to have the trust from these legends, Spike must have had a background with these gents, either through years of playing on the same bills, attending shows, running in similar social circles, or perhaps them even respecting his own unique drumming skills. Regardless of how he made it happen, I understand how much sweat and research it takes to put just one episode together, not to mention a series of goldmine interviews. The second thing I was attracted to, and the aspect I have the most difficulty with, is his ease of conversation. Spike's personality is built for mainstream media. He's got a very relaxed flow to his one-on-ones, which highlights his youthful sense of humor. Him being an author, you can tell his research and preparation is unmatched as far as any niche music host I've seen on similar platforms. The book he put out a couple years ago is called Mad, Bad, and Dangerous. It's a collection of iconic drummer stories combined seamlessly into a hilarious yet insightful look at real rock and roll life, behind the scenes, on the road, backstage, in the kitchen, on a plane, in a back alley, and even in prison. If you love all the greasy details about what made these particular bands tick, and or even explode, this is a hard book to put down, and I'm not much of a reader. Let's have Spike tell you more about it, and his upcoming Part 2 book, as we check in with him. Here he is, the next major UK primetime TV personality, if I have anything to do with it, Mr. Spike Webb.
Coming home from a gig, weren't you?
It was like the first show of the tour, first show, and everything was fine. It was like one of the best nights of my life, you know, unexpected, but we just had a snowstorm. So I was driving on, I live in the mountains, so I was coming home at like 2 a.m. I really don't even remember it, but I got the van rolled a few times, I got ejected, I was paralyzed for a few days, and I was in the hospital for 30 days, and then I ended up having spinal cord surgery, so I never thought I'd be able to play again, but went ahead and had the surgery, had a friend deliver a drum kit, electronic drum kit to the hospital, and the doctors were pissed off about that, just so something I could look at, you know. And I was able to, you know, play on little trash cans, and I had a catheter in. There's like videos of this on my Facebook thing. Just trying to get that positive flow going. So, you know, fast forward, it's been an adventure every day. And at the depths of the pity party, you know, it's like, what can I do that's positive to get me out of this mind state?
Yeah.
So I just said, why don't I reach out to the drummers who maybe want to play in the first place, right? And just, I'm not an interviewer. Like, I have watched some of your stuff, and your personality is so great, and you're an author, and you're magnetic, you know. And I've always been a loner. Even on tour, I stay to myself. I go on adventures by myself, and I come back for the show.
Yeah.
So it's been other kinds of therapy for me to even have a discussion like this, you know. And it's developed over. I'm going on a year now. My first one was Martin Chambers, The Pretenders, and that was like my first choice, you know, and right out of the box.
Now I got very good one. I have to say, very good choice.
Yeah. And it's been building, and it's, you know, there's vulnerability, talking about the accident and getting stronger, and just discussing ideas with the people I looked up to, because I played, you know, self-taught and all that.
Same here. Yeah.
Yeah. But when I came... Oh, so I was to YouTube and social media very late, pretty much the crash after, and I did find you, and I was especially interested because you had a handful of guys that I thought were untouchable, and I think you, I mean, I'm very grateful for the people I've been able to talk to, and I'm pretty much like, I'm done, like, I've found my guys, you know, but there were a few that were like, wow, and then you actually had a handful of these guys, you know. And not only that, you're a great storyteller, and you make the conversations very smooth, and you're really funny and intelligent, and you're a drummer, so you can talk both technically and you can be, you know, a narrator, and it's a unique combination. So I just wanted to reach out to you and say, like, I'm really impressed by what you're doing. I'm not, you know, and I wanted to point people, I'm not even sure if there's a second book, or if you're working on one right now.
Well, there is one. It's nearly finished. The publisher, John Blake, my agent put the second book idea to him, Mad Band Dangerous 2, and he just said, well, I've done one, and he knew most of the people in that book, and he sort of said, well, you know, he didn't really want to do another one. But since then, and this is some years ago now, the original book has been continued to do well on Amazon, and it's still selling. So, as I say, the second book is nearly finished, and the stories in that are equally as funny. Some of them are hilarious, you know, because I've got some stories from the original people, but loads of new guys, loads of Kenny Jones, Rob Gaynor, loads of new people in there as well. As I say, it's three quarters finished. I don't know if it's going to happen or not. But of course, one can do it oneself now a lot more easily. So I don't know what's going to happen with that. I'd love to be published again by a major publisher, because something like that, a book like that, is much better produced by a publisher than someone like me. I recently published something else, which has nothing to do with drumming, which I would have to do on my own because it's not of a major interest. But this really would need to be done, I think, by a publisher like John Blake. But in answer to your question, it is nearly finished. So, you know,
you have that many more stories in your archive.
Yes, I do. Wow. I've got loads, and. Mm-hmm. Some of them are very funny indeed. I mean, they're really hilarious. Because the ones in the original one weren't, they were more sort of intrigue, really. A couple of funny ones, or some funny ones, but intriguing ones as well. But most of the ones in the second book are actually a bit more sort of outrageous, I suppose. But I'm glad. I'm glad you picked up on that, because it's kind of something I shelved a little bit, but I still have a, you know, something in here makes me want to, you know, finish that up, you know. But
it's a labor of love. Oh yeah, go ahead.
A labor of love, exactly. I mean, I'll tell you a little bit. This might sort of strike a bit of a chord with you, because you've had to get over this terrible accident, and to get to play again and whatever. And you said to me mentioned in your email that you were 70% or 75% behind the kid again.
Yeah, 75%.
Well, that's fabulous after what you've been through. And to do that is real determination. And it's about belief, isn't it? It's about belief in yourself. And I'll tell you a very brief story, which is what I tell some people when they ask about Mad, Bad and Dangerous. I tell them that when I first had this idea, it was with another drummer in a place called The Horns, in a Horns venue, pub venue in Watford, in Hertfordshire, near London. And it's a great venue. And I was just hanging around in there quite some years ago now, like maybe 13 years ago or something. Yeah. And I was chatting to another drummer friend of mine, and we were just talking about what it's like to be a drummer. And we were just having a bit of a moan, actually, saying, well, you know, people keep saying, can you move it? Or, you know, can you shut up? You know, can you get out of the way? You know, do you need this cymbal? You know, it's right. That sort of thing. On small stages in venues like that. And so he said, we should write a book, you know, and we should call it Tales from the High Chair. Everything drummers wanted to complain about but couldn't be asked, you know. And I went away, and a couple of months later, I started doing it. And I was sitting in an office in London as a copywriter in advertising, and I was sitting there writing stories about myself, because I didn't know any famous people. Particularly, I knew a couple of people, but not, you know, a couple of contacts, but no really famous people. I knew a guy called actually a great friend of mine who played with Manfred Mann, and called John Lingwood, and he's a mate of mine. And but I didn't really know anyone else, close to fame. So I said to myself, Spike, what are you doing? This is a waste of time. There's no point in doing this, because it's a great idea, but if you want to meet lots of famous people, because otherwise it won't get published, they won't be interested in what you do. People like all these famous people have people employed to get rid of people like you.
Yeah.
I thought, you know, why am I doing it? Yes, of course, it's a good idea, but it's not possible. So I thought, maybe I won't bother. 2 hours later, I got an email. And it, to this day, I don't know where it came from. But it's one of those rogue emails you get, you know. And we're talking about, you know, 2007 or something. And it said three words, believe in yourself.
Wow. It's random.
And I thought, that could never have been a better timed email. And I thought, you know what, I think that's coming from somewhere important. I don't know where it's coming from, but, you know, it couldn't have hit at a better time. So fast forward a couple of years or a year, and I've met, you know, Nick Mason, you know, Pink Floyd. I've met Top of Heaven from The Clash. I've met, you know, The Jam, Madness, Status Quo, you know, loads, all of them. And I'm thinking, you know, and the more, of course, the more you build your connections, as we know, the more the network grows. And they all said, I got a better story than that. You know, some of them did. They're lovely guys, and not that hard to get hold of, actually, at all.
Still, you must have amazing communication skills. Like, not everyone has a way of reaching out and trying to reserve a chat. You know, I have friends, it's like, I don't even know how they're able to tie their shoes in the morning and get in the car. Like, they can't complete a sentence, but you're trying to hook up, you're trying to build something, and you're trying to show respect at the same time, and that you know what you're talking about because you're a drummer. And so that's a very unique skill set, and able to communicate a business email to a manager or whoever's taking care of them.
Yeah.
In order to say you're not a crazy person. Like, sometimes I even preface that, like, this is how I'm not a crazy person, you know, and somehow I'm trying to prove to them, you know, that I'm just a drummer. I'm not
Well, that helps. You're quite right. Yeah, yeah. I know what you mean. You're quite right. And thank you for that. But yes, absolutely. The fact that I wasn't a journalist really helped. because I was a drummer and I was able to have empathy with what they wanted to talk about, because I thought the last thing they want to talk about is rudiments and stuff like that. Mm. They probably want to talk about all the nonsense that goes on and all the stuff that lots of other people don't talk about, you know, and they wanted to have a bit of fun. And so did I. So the idea was, and the agent that I eventually managed to get, bless her, a lovely lady, and she got me published. Jane Graham Moore is that's a story behind that, but I won't go on about that now. But she recognised the fact that the idea of the book would be, it's the drummer's stories, but not about technique. It's about what it's like to be a drummer and about the life of the drummer and about stuff that's happened and stuff you might not even, you know, expect to know about, you know, or whatever. So yeah. So it was an unknown journey, really. And it just took its, you know, it just kind of, and I wrote this thing in maybe in the, you know, most of it was in the local library. And sometimes I go to a pub and get a laptop up and, you know, because I don't write at home normally because I need to go somewhere to work. So
yeah.
I made it work rather than, I made it a project. I actually thought, hang on, I've really got to do this. And because I saw the three words, believe in yourself. I still don't know. I'll never know where they came from. Or maybe one day, but I don't know. But I like the thing is, it's about the belief. The thing is, you've believed in yourself enough to get over this awful experience and go back to playing the kit.
Yeah. Which, it's because it's the only thing that really... I'm a simple person, you know, I like my stupid sports teams. I love playing the drums and I love writing music. I have a little school here called Loud House. I teach little kids all the instruments. Performing is really, I became joyless after the accident.
Yeah.
So I needed to work on something. And like, as you said, those three words that came to you, it's really strange. Like 1 week I'll be working on, just because I have this drop foot. It's very common for spinal cord injuries to have that feet that drag, you know. So I go in for all kinds of injections and electricity therapy and all this. I'm reaching out to try to do anything.
Yeah.
So I'll be improving 1 week, working on some kind of 16th note foot shuffle thing. Yeah. The next week, I'll think nothing's improved since the hospital. I'll throw the drums across the room. Like, I'm never touching them again. And my wife's a drummer, too.
All right.
She'll be upstairs, and she's an audio genius. She works on putting audio in sports stadiums. Anyway, she's like, "What's the problem? You sound the same." And I'm like, "Oh, I'm like breathing fire, throw this stuff anyway. I can't get this, you know, tricky thing. You know, maybe if like an average friend walked in and said, like, "What's the problem? You sound the same." But to me, I sound like I'm 13 years old. So I'm always working on like something very technical, because I'm trying to get back to where I was. Anyway, the three words thing, it's like just randomly 2 days ago, the same band that I was in when I crashed, Roger Fisher and his brother Michael, the Magic Man, they rehired me to be back in that band. So I'm like, the last 2 days I've been cramming heart songs because we have three shows coming up in July. So it's like that's kind of pulled me out. Like, it's not like, oh, you're back, but it's like, okay, you know.
And the thing is that, you know, the COVID thing over, you know, has stopped me playing a full kit for 18 months now. And I've been same as you, you know, you think you're playing like a 13-year-old, and I've not even had an accident, you know. So it's like, you know, 18 months and I've started teaching a guy, or mentoring rather, a friend somewhere where I work, her son, lovely guy, Stanley, he's just turned, you know, 16, and he really wants to play drums, and he's taught himself pretty well. So I went to this little, to this very good drum studio and recording studio where we can hire and whatever for free in the afternoons, because it's for people who want to learn their craft, it's free. So we went in, and I've been doing it for a while now, a couple of months. And sometimes I have to show him something, you know, not much, not often, but, you know, I've got a bit of arthritis in my finger, so which I acquired after lockdown. So I'm not sure how that's going to pan out when I play a gig. But I started to play something, and I was thinking, hang on,
wait a minute, I can't do it. Hang on. This isn't right. You know, I don't know if I can do this because it's, you know, since I'm 62 now and I was 12 the last time I didn't play the drums for 18 months, you know, and I'm thinking, right. Hang on, that's, you know, that's sort of like that. This isn't, you know, I'm worried about that. But then I thought again, like, you know, believe in yourself, because I said this to Bob Henrit, who played with Arjun and the Kinks and whatever, and he's a good friend of mine, and he's in the book as well. But he said to me, Spike, you know, we're all having it, we're all getting it. You know, anybody who doesn't play for a long time is going to have a problem with. It's not like riding a bike. They say it is, but it's not, because riding a bike is not about what's in your head. It's about what's physical. But playing music's about what's in your head. Mm-hmm. As well, and if it's not been in your head and physically expressed on a regular basis, then you're going to need to re-harness it. It doesn't mean you can't, and that's why one shouldn't panic when you don't do it immediately. Of course it will come back, of course it will. It's believing yourself stuff. But and going back to yourself, I think it's quite an achievement that you've managed to do what you've done, to be honest. So I would say you're further on the road than people like me are, to be honest. You know,
my wife always references the movie The Matrix. I'm defragged right now. You know, every part of me is just kind of floating, waiting to reset. You know, and unfortunately, I go through more frustrations than I do victories. And I think if I was victory every day, I might be further along. But I'm too much of an emotional drummer. I've always been in like bashing bands.
There's nothing wrong with that. I mean, you know, emotional. I mean, you know, some of my favorite drummers are, you know, incredibly expressive. You know, it's like, well, I don't know. Most drummers are expressive. Of course, they have expression. But I don't know. Who are your favorites? Who are your favorites?
Just overall. I mean, Martin was like my first love as far as, you know, the first Pretenders record made me want to play rock and roll. I was always a huge Beatles fan.
Yeah, Ringo, yeah.
Yeah, so unique. More of a Michael DeRozier fan than a Bonham fan, and I think they're very similar. I just think Michael DeRozier took it to another more aggressive level to what he was doing. And then as far as like discipline and being on the grid, of course, Neil Peart and like outside the box stuff, all the early Missing Persons records was just blowing my mind with all this flamadiddle-diddles around his 100-piece kit and call and response stuff with his hands and feet really opened up a lot. And then, you know, I didn't know much that much about reggae when I was growing up, so it's, of course, The Police, you know, that's where I got that dose of...
Oh, yeah, Stuart Copeland. Well, very expressive. Innovative player, really. I love the emotional expression in Phil Collins stuff. That he did, but certainly with Genesis, you know, and after that. Of course, the poor guy, I mean, I don't think he can do it. You know, he doesn't do it anymore. I think his son does it now when he tours, or a lot of it. But one of my favorite drummers, Phil Collins. Ringo, Charlie Watts, Steve Gadd, you know, all sorts of loads of them, you know.
I think when I was like really getting good, when I was really concentrating, I'd go home after school, no girlfriends, you know, I grew up in a beach community. I didn't surf. It was just music all the time after school.
Yeah.
Once the paradiddles and the double strokes got to sound like White Noise, I always went back to the song, you know, and there was with the instructional drummers who had passed through, and I would go to some of these conventions, you know, and then they'd all... I went to one at a guitar center in Hollywood when I was like 17. There was everyone. This was when Picaro was alive. There was Bozio, Myron Grombacher, the Apiche brothers. Like everyone was there. And then, you know, Kali Yuda was there. Gad or Weckl was there. And I was listening to all this. And much like when the Buddy Rich Memorial with Gad and Kali Yuda and Weckl. It's like when it was Gad's turn, and this isn't talking shit at all. Like, I would never be able to do that stuff. And it's very impressive. But once it almost turned into like, it had turned into a Queen song. Like, everyone got so into it, you know. It's not simple, but he knew how to use his limbs for power in order to get his audience involved. And that's the same thing I knew when I went to drum shows It's like, that's cool. I mean, but it's so close. But that guy has a sound. Like, I'm sure the way Spike hits the snare drum is different than a million other drummers, and that's what makes your swing. I've been told through other bands, like, okay, you got the audition, but have you actually been in a room with them before? Because you need to make sure you're in the room, because you have a certain sound to the way you hit the snare. And that's when I discovered how drummers contribute to the band with the way they hit certain drums. A certain sound comes out. They have a certain swing, and it's almost not replaceable.
Yeah, absolutely. Quite so. You couldn't, I mean, you know, one of my best drum intro fills ever is incredibly simple, but really it talks. And that's when Ringo Starr comes in, the first bit of drumming on Hey Jude. You listen to the song Hey Jude, and it comes in when it just sort of goes into a sort of a middle of a verse, really. It might be it's not a middle eight. It goes up a bit in the verse. He just comes in, and the drums haven't been in before. He just comes in. He does something incredibly simple, but he just uses what's available to him in a really, in a tapestry way. What he does is he paints a little picture before you get into, it's very tiny, before you get into the back into the song. And it's just a little way of drifting you into the fact that the drums are coming in, but it's wonderful. And the thing is, what's also wonderful is he wouldn't have planned it. It's what he felt. It's what he felt at the time, because that's what the song was telling him and making him feel. And that's his genius, as is so many other drummers, you know. So many other drummers do the same thing, and some incredibly technical, brilliant people do the same thing. Dave Grohl is another example of somebody who just plays absolutely perfectly for the band that he's in.
Right.
And I mean, all these, you know, there's so many drummers that I don't think I've ever really heard a dreadful drummer, to be honest. They're because the very nature of what you do, if you get to a certain level, is that it's going to be you, and some are more recognizable than others. And as you say, how you hit the snare is incredibly important, because it's how the backbeat or how it's used fits with your style of fitting into the tapestry, if you like, of the song. So you might get somebody who whacks the snare too loud on one song, or whatever. But actually, it gives something. It's really odd. It's like the beginning of Start Me Up, the Rolling Stones. It's like, you know, it goes,
one of the craziest drum intros.
He just hit it, you know. Yeah. But they kept it because it was just spot on.
Comes in such an odd spot.
Yeah, it's just a really odd spot, but it works. Yeah. It really, really works. And then he kind of drifts back in. And the rest of the drumming on it is great, because it's just sort of slightly behind the pulse.
It's a 16th, but he's really just laying into that eighth note accent.
I was talking to a friend of mine today, and he said, the thing about a lot of drummers is it's great when they you said, you know, a drummer actually, you know, drives the band. It's great when they drive from behind, you know, when they actually push it from behind, because what they're doing is they're allowing everyone else to do their stuff, but they're kind of pushing it. But when they want it to go really, if it's not going, you know, if it's not up to speed, then they make sure it is. But it's a bit like that. It's like a kind of a holding back. Of course,
Charlie really wouldn't work in Green Day.
Say?
Charlie wouldn't really work in Green Day.
No, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. It's horses for courses. There's a lot of, you know, you wouldn't put certain drummers in certain bands, but when they play in the right bands, then they can be regarded as an accolade of a great, you know, examples of great drummers. I mean, you know, Joey Jordison, for instance, you know, there are people like that are fantastic at what they do, and it's very few people that can do that sort of thing.
I kind of like both. I like the Jordy Slipknot, and I like the new Slipknot. I like they just play differently. Yeah. They both work.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, all of it is just brilliant stuff, and there's nothing, you know, there's no incorrect way of doing it, really. It's just a question of what one's taste is, I suppose.
They're just a pop band to me. They're one of my favorites, but I mean, they just write good songs.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, great stuff. Oh, yeah. I was watching a great video the other day, and it's Barry White live. You know, the Walrus of Soul, live, I think it's Paris or somewhere. And he's doing You See the Trouble with Me, one of my favorite tracks of his, and First One, Last One, Everything. But these guys, the percussionists and the drummer and the percussionist are just fabulous. They're having such a great time. But they really are actually, they're spot on, but I think they're doing what they want. You know, the orchestra is doing that, you know, the conductor's there, because he was a great orchestrator, Barry White. He's going down the front, you know, and he's sort of doing his stuff and whatever. But these guys are having a great time. I don't think they're reading, to be honest. I think they're briefed to say, right, this, you know what to do, guys, just enjoy yourselves. Because there's one shot where this percussionist, he's got sticks, but he's on timbales, and he's next to the drummer, and he just got this, he's just going, and he does this big smile, he's going like that, just because he wants to, you know. Yeah. I don't think he's been told to. He knows it should be there, it could have been slightly differently done, or whatever. He just chose to do it that way, and it was spot on, absolutely fantastic. So I love to see that sort of thing, when it's, you know, really enjoyed in a situation where it hasn't been instructed at all. You know, that it might have been, I might be wrong, and maybe he was told to do exactly that, I don't know, but they were moving around so much he couldn't possibly have read anything, you know.
I've seen so many live videos, especially like the big benefit festivals, where the percussionist is usually just dancing around smiling, adding a little thing here and there. Speaking of percussionists, I just talked to Sue Hajopoulos yesterday, and she's percussionist, Simple Minds, Cyndi Lauper, Joe Jackson. But
yes, you said that she played with Cyndi Lauper. Yeah, Simple Minds as well. Yeah, yeah.
So the first video I saw that you did was Mel Gaynor, of course, like one of my favorites. So powerful. But you said there was drumming going on in the background. Is that a school you work at? Is that the college, or is that just a temporary spot to do the interview?
Oh, was there drumming going on in the background of that? Yeah. That of the Mel Gaynor one?
Yeah.
That was probably something that our friend Jerome Marcus had on in the background, because we did it in his studio.
Okay.
Outside his studio. And he might have had something going on in the background, but I think also we had Jody Linscott there on another occasion. But I think, no, that day there was no one else there. I don't know what was going on in the back there. It was probably something that he was, you know, he had on me. I think possibly. I do work in a school though.
Okay.
But we don't, it's a special needs thing in St. Albans near where I live with my
wife. I've seen a few other Mel Gaynor interviews, and that one was very, very good. Very
interesting. Did you like that one though? I remember asking him, you know, at the time there was this thing about drummers being apparently more intelligent than other people.
Yeah.
He said, I'd like to know where that came from.
Yeah.
Certainly isn't true. Well, I don't know. But
I'm going to go back to your book a little bit, if I could. I just wanted to mention, to have other people who maybe don't have the book or haven't heard of the book, that could point them towards you. So the drummers I was talking about that I was like, oh my God, you know, I wish I could have a little chat, was like Topper Heaton, Nick Mason.
Oh, Topper, yeah.
Rick Butler from The Jam, Kenny Jones, Gilson Lavis from Squeeze.
Yeah.
And you mentioned Bob Hennert from The Kinks and
a
few other bands. One that I was thinking of, maybe you know him, or maybe you've had chatted with him. You know Terry Chambers from XTC?
No, I know the name. I never met him. I'd like to, because I think he's a great drummer.
See, like I was mentioning, because your personality, you're a great communicator and you're a drummer, which is, you know, you're ahead in as far as getting these people trust to talk to them and build your thing. So whether it be through your like personal relationships or like the protocol you use, I'm lucky enough. I think I'm batting like 900, you know, like I'm very few just straight up reject, you know, for whatever reason. But I'm wondering, in your experience, you don't have to name any names, but sometimes I'll get a manager who's just straight up rude, like, no, I don't care, blah, blah, blah. Sometimes I'll get a manager who'll string me along for like 6-7 months, and at the very end, You know, be like, not interested. And then I'll get like one of the biggest drummers you've ever heard in rock history write me a personal letter saying, I love what you're doing. I'm just working on something else right now, you know.
Didn't we have Greg Bissonnet?
Yeah, like Doors, like that, you know, that almost happened, that kind of thing. Or I'm not going to mention any others, but have you ever come across situations, and you don't have to mention names, because it seems like you're very efficient, where you're like, oh, that's too bad. I was expecting a different outcome.
Well, funnily enough, I only had, because I was on a time scale thing here, so I had to stop it at a certain time. One of the last ones I tried to get hold of was Phil Collins. But he was really nice about it, and he it was his agent that and only got through to his agent through someone I happened to know through something else, which was a coincidence. It was a really nice reply. He just said, his agent said, Phil says, you know, great idea. Thanks very much for asking me, but I'll pass on this one, but all the best with it. Yeah. Which was a really nice reply. And I think it was at a time when I think it was round about when he had to pack up drumming because of some physical disability. Something in his back or something, I don't know. But it was a really nice way of saying good luck and thanks for asking, you know. It was, and I think under other circumstances, he probably would have done it, you know, and he might even do it now. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I never know. I didn't get anything unpleasant from anybody at all. I got no, I didn't get any no's at all, actually. I was very lucky. I didn't get any no's. I got hold of Steve White through someone else I know, and he said, yeah, you know. But by that time, the thing is that in my experience, all the drummers I've ever met have always been delightful and really helpful. And they didn't, you know, none of them had any qualms about it at all. They if they were busy, then fine, you know. I even got invited to John Moss from Culture Club invited me and opened up a cafe that was closed near where he lives in Hampstead for the afternoon, just so we could have a coffee and get his story, you know, which was really nice, you know. So, they were more than accommodating, very nice. And
I just thought it was a little funny, and there's no bitterness at all. Like I'm like way past, you know, collecting some of the most amazing talent and share their thoughts. But the ones where it was like when COVID was like at its peak, and it's like, yeah, we're too busy. Like we've got too much going on right now.
Well, the thing is, you see, COVID hasn't helped. You know,
yeah.
People are insecure about what they're doing themselves, let alone anything else. And so you're up against it a bit because of that, I would say as well. So you might find it would be different, you know, before that or even after. You know, hopefully after will be fairly soon. So. But I would like to, you know, if you haven't got a copy of my book, I'm quite happy to put one in the post to you.
Oh, God, I'd love one. I mean, I'll just buy one. You don't have to worry about that.
No. I'm quite happy to put one in the post to you because it's a nicer way of doing it. If you just, you know, on the Facebook message thing, just send me your address over there in Seattle and I'll send you one.
Sure. Thanks so much. I'm sure you've gotten through the years, you've gotten so much support, you know, as you post these videos. But as like a novice interviewer who's just trying to put positive stuff out there and really not make any money off of it all, just it's helping me. I have run into obsessed fans, and they're surprised that I'm able to get in contact with their hero. And since the interview didn't go the way they wanted it to, they're very negative. And I'm wondering, I'm wondering if you've ever come across, you know, people just like, how could you possibly ask that question? Or how in the world did you get in the room with?
I'll tell you what, I've had people talking on because the YouTube channel now is at over 500,000 views.
Yeah.
And sometimes I go back onto it and I look at it and it gets some really funny comments, and they're quite reasonable, really. I mean, there's one guy who watched the Kenny Jones one who said, "What's up with that bloke's haircut?" he was referring to me, not Kenny Jones.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
"What's up with this bloody hair?" Yeah. You know, I thought it was really funny. I looked at it, I thought, yeah, he's got a point, you know. It's kind of... You know, and I think, you know, if you could have seen his face when he was writing, he was probably laughing, you know, and I'd like to meet him, have a laugh with him, you know. I do get some things. I have had some stuff which is very negative.
Yeah.
As in the interviewer butts in too much, or, you know, but what they don't realize is that I'm not famous. So I'm not a trained interviewer or a presenter. I'm just doing this because I'm lucky enough to have been published and lucky enough to have my dear nephew who happens to have a film company. And at the time when we started this, it's doing well, but now we're doing well now. But at the time, we were doing our best, you know, and I wasn't, you know, I'd never interviewed anybody before at all, before Mad, Bad and Dangerous on YouTube. So, of course, I wasn't experienced, you know. And so they're quite right to say, you know, the interviewer didn't impress me much, because, of course, I wouldn't do, you know. I'm not a trained TV presenter or anything. So I didn't mind that at all. But I also got some very positive stuff, some really nice stuff, saying, actually, the interviewer style was great. He did let the... drummers talk, and he was very, very funny, you know. So I got some really positive stuff, more positive than negative, but the negative stuff doesn't matter, because that's not really what I set out to do. I set out to write books and play drums, not, you know. I love doing it, though. The presenting thing is great fun, and we could have some laughs, you know. I made Top of Heddon laugh a lot when I couldn't say the word Dave.
I love that one. Yeah.
Did you see that? I couldn't say Damon Albarn, because he let us use his studio, and I wanted to thank him, but I couldn't say the word for some reason. And he's sort of like pissing himself. So that's great fun. Some of the takeout stuff we did was fun, but all of it was fun. You know, none of it was not fun, you know.
So some people just don't realize that a few of these people they have a hard time talking themselves.
Yes, they do.
Some, you just push go and it's scripted. They're just going. They're used to doing it, and now they're gonna go for an hour. Some, I'm just like, it's like extracting teeth, like from a shy person. It's like, and then I get complaints like, "You talk too much." And it's like, you have no idea how shy this guy is. I'm like trying to pull stuff out of them, you know. Not only that, I mean, you don't know my background. You don't know anything about me. Like, you just do some research and like. Anyway, I'm mostly like very, very happy and very humbled, but I'm too emotional and I'm too sensitive to like, I've only been responding with positivity and love and flowers, you know. I'm never like, "You don't know what you're talking about," or anything like that. It's all very general, but I was just curious about that, because you have like, you know, way more views, way more fans and stuff like that. So someone who's been through it before.
It's a funny thing to have come across, because I, you know, when I first wrote the book, I had no idea that I would be talking to these people again on camera, on a YouTube channel, and then meeting loads of other people after that who came on board as a result of that, and a friend of ours who was an industry consultant who put us in touch with people like, you know, Mel Gaynor and Gilson Lavis and people like that, Kenny Jones. We went to Kenny Jones' place, and we were in the car, and this guy, he had the number of his gate, you know, and he's just pressing it in, this private gate, which then opened. And we went up, and then we drove, we got out of the car. He said, "How the hell do you get in here?" We said, "Well," he said, "I remembered it from last time," you know. there's a lot of banter that goes on. Yeah. One of the nicest things, which was off camera, which we did shoot, was Kenny Jones showing me stuff on the wall of his studio. There was a lot of awards and things and pictures and quite impressive historic stuff. there's one thing which was really lovely, which was a letter from Keith Moon's mum to him the night before his first gig replacing Keith Moon, because he was the first replacement for Keith Moon. It said something like, you know, good luck, Kenny, hope it goes well, love, whatever her name was, you know. And he said, you know, don't photograph this. Don't put this on YouTube, you know. And we I think we actually deleted it because he asked us to. We haven't got that anymore. And he said, because it's very, he said, it's the, forget the rest. This is the best thing on the wall. It's the most important thing on this wall, you know, which was a lovely thing to say. And we respectfully didn't keep that.
Sure.
We, you know, we got rid of it because, so we thought, no, that's fair enough, you know, so we don't have it anymore, you know. But, and you know, a lot of the walkabout stuff we do, that you see at the beginning of the those interviews, that's all done afterwards. it's all done at the end, because I've got to know, because it always looks like we've sort of we met before, you know, we're all pals. But actually, we do the walkabout afterwards because we knew that they'd feel more relaxed about that, having done the interview. So we do have, we have a chat and shake hands and talk about it beforehand. Then we do the interview. Then we do the walkabout thing where we're, you know, I'm talking to the guy from Saxon as we're walking into the pub in Watford and whatever, you know. We did that, you know, after we'd done the interview. It wasn't actually a welcome in at all, because that's the best way around to do it. It's cheating a bit, but at the same time, it's more relaxed, you know, that way, and it needs to look like that. But the first one we did was Nick Mason. That's the first one we did. And we had literally two cameras.
That was your very first?
Very first one was Nick Mason. Okay. And we went up on the train. My nephew was only 19 at the time. And so we're going back a long way now. You know, his film company is now, like, you know, then he had, like, you know, two cameras, one for a wide. And no, I think it was, one for a wide and one for close-up. And but they had lights on the front. They were quality, though. They had lights on the front. And we went to this place near King's Cross, just down from King's Cross. And this office he had was just huge. It was full of all these drum kits and a racing car. But, you know, because he likes to race, you know, he's a racing car driver. And we were sort of setting up near this drum kit. The drum kit we were setting up in front of was the Dark Side of the Moon tour drum kit that he took on Dark Side of the Moon. And no, it was his kit, actually. It was his current kit back then in 2012. We were, you know, George, my nephew, was setting up his cameras, and he was backing onto this Ferrari, you know, this open top Ferrari sports car. I said, George, don't, whatever you do, fall onto that, because that would be a really bad thing to do, you know. He said, yeah, I know. So we're sitting there, and he'd already said to us, just sit up there, guys, I'll be back in a minute. Secretary Vicks, lovely lady, you know, she said, yeah, you want to think, no, it's fine. And he sat down there, and he was delightful, absolutely delightful, really accommodating, very funny as well. And afterwards, he took me around, and we did a George filmed us walking around the, you know, that area, and he showed me, the drum kit that he went on the Dark Side of the Moon tour with, you know, and he said, this is what I use for this, you know, and this is my current drum kit, and I said, oh, yeah, it's a DW. I've got a DW. And I said, the trouble is, I've got the spurs have gone on my bass drum, and I can't, you know, I can't replace them, because I go to DW. They said, send me photographs. And I get filled. He said, oh, don't worry, just send it through the post to me while I get one of my man to replace it for you. Nice fella, you know.
Oh, God.
And we walked around, and, you know, it was just this dark, you know, Pink Floyd wine, red wine that they'd had, you know, they make this wine, you know, I don't know if they do now, but they did for a while. And he said, yeah, the trouble is the French have got hold of it. He said, apparently it's actually not bad, you know, but the French have got hold of it. I said, well, you know, don't you do anything about this? And no, there's no point in arguing with the French winemakers. There's no point in arguing. So he's very funny, and he's a really nice fellow. I had a lovely time there. And
very gracious of him to take you around the grounds.
He just took me around, showed me around. Yeah. You know, I did, you know, and we got that on film, but we put that at the front because it looked good. You know, it sort of looked better than putting it. And also, we wanted people to see it because at the end of the interview, a lot of people just switch off, you know, but it's always a nice thing to people see. So that's what kind of gave us the brief to do that in general, just do a walkabout first and then, you know, or last, and then put it at the beginning, you know. It's just a little trick, really, but it doesn't matter either way. But that's something that, you know, another thing we did was we, you know, I didn't have any cue cards because we didn't have that facility, but I used to write this stuff on big, I used to have a little notes, you know, so you're looking down when you're interviewing, but you're looking down, it doesn't look very good. So we put them up on big bits of paper with gaffer tape on a pole so that I'd look across occasionally because you only had a time frame. And so I'd think, well, hey, I've got to get onto that subject now. That's, you know.
I was looking for makes my it more piece natural. Of paper. I have a piece of paper that's folded in fours.
Oh, right.
In categories. And then when I get here, I kind of put it up next to the screen on a, you know, like a sheet.
Yeah.
So I can kind of toggle, but
yeah.
Everyone has their own.
Their own ways of, yeah.
Speaking of Spike, the drummer, though, you know, one thing that comes up so common when I talk to these drummers is, yeah, I started out pounding on my couch pillows in boxes. And I read that that was, that you had the same story. I know what that is. And before you get a kit, you know, an actual kit where you go down to the mart and put a drum kit together. But do you, and then you said, you know, Simon Phillips was kind of in the neighborhood, and that's who you got your first private lesson from?
That's right. I played an upturn washing up bowls and cardboard boxes and stuff. And I had a cat basket as a bass drum with no pedal because I thought it looked good, you know. And so I was only 12. You know? And anyway, my dad was an estate agent at the time. And just up the road from us in Bushy, Sid Phillips, the old Simon Phillips' dad, had bought the place through my dad's estate agent. He was either selling it or buying it. I can't remember which now. But anyway, I was 11, I think, or 12, and I think Simon was 13. But anyway, my dad was talking to this Sid Phillips in his living room, and there was a drum kit there. And he said, oh, my son wants to play the drums. You know, he's playing on pots and pans and that. He said, oh, well, my son Simon, he's been playing for a while now. He said, why don't you bring him up? You know, you can have a go on the real kit, you know. So he did. And I sat there, and I remember sitting there. They gave me a Coca-Cola, I remember, which was, you know, 11, 12 was very nice to be given a Coca-Cola in someone else's house, you know. And I was sitting there, and Sid did a piano piece, and Simon Phillips, who would have been 13 at the time, I suppose, played along to it, you know, and it was a jazz piece, you know, but I'd never seen anything like it, the way he moved, the way he did this stuff, you know, and I was in awe of it, really, and then I was allowed to sit at the kit, you know, and Simon put me on there, and I think I tried to do with two hands, because I'd never played pedals, I didn't have any pedals at home, I was 12, you know? So I did Honky Tonk Woman on the first rack tom and the snare. I just went, that's all I did. That's all I knew how to do. I'd never seen a hi-hat before. You know?
Mm-hmm.
I'd seen them on telly on top of the pots where they were like, you know, puppets because they couldn't hit the drums properly. You know? But because they had to mime, you know.
Yeah.
And I think I went back there once more and I did. Well, I did, because Simon then showed me the how to do the, you know, bass drum, hi-hat, snare, you know, ride. You know, so, but which I could sort of do anyway, because it was getting natural, because I played so much on my makeshift thing at home, even though I had no pedals. And I remember doing that and thinking, right, so, you know, I've got a bit of what, you know, the basics, you know, because at home I was just playing with hands. I was doing all the bass drum stuff on my little cans there and stuff, all washing up bowls. And I got home and my mum was really worried because I didn't touch my makeshift pretend drum kit for about a week or two.
Mm.
And she said, I thought that might happen because he's seen a real one. He's seen someone who can play it properly and he's going to give up, you know. But I didn't. And I thought, no, I'm not doing that. And of course, I was at school, I was at school with other guys who wanted to play music. And so there's a guy at the road called Mace Carnican, Michelangelo Carnican. Mace was his nickname. He lived up the road from me, roughly my age.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a piano player. And we were mates. We used to knock around. And he said, let's get some. He had a bongo. He had a Kenyan bongo that his elder sister had brought back from Africa or something. And so I used to play the bongo while he was messing about with the piano. And we formed a band. And then we got some other guys from school interested in joining this thing. And Michelangelo Mace, incidentally, is the younger brother of Knox Carnican, Knox from the Vibrators. And they're still playing now, funnily enough.
Wow.
And he's in his 70s and he's still doing it. But anyway, when I eventually played a real drum kit, which was lent to me by Mace's cousin, Richard, from the Motors in those days, it was at a school gig in a classroom. And I hadn't played, I hadn't sat behind a real drum kit since Simon Phillips, probably 2 years before, had shown me how to,
was it a real drum brand, or was it kind of like the first step, some other brand? Because I went to a drum kit after Boxes and Pillows to where the toms really didn't set quite right, and they were manufactured. Things just weren't working, but it was
this one was... It was good, this one, because he was playing the Motors, and so it was a proper brand.
Legit.
I can't remember which one it was, but I did play it in the classroom, in this little classroom at the end of year sort of classroom party or whatever, and I could play. I could just do it. It was just there. I hadn't done anything with my feet at all since then, for at least a year, probably more, but I could just do it because it was in my head. It got into my head. So Simon Phillips had got it into my head. So thanks to him, it didn't need any more than it being shown to me. And because I was so determined to do it, it got in my head and I kind of did it. And since then, we formed a band at school, and then we, rehearsed at mates' houses and stuff like that. And thereby hangs a tale, but really it was determination. I suppose it was, again, believe in yourself. It's sort of, you see a guy with a real drum kit and you've only got pots and pans, you have to believe in yourself,
Yeah.
And that sort of, and years later that came, that same three-word thing is relevant with the Mad, Bad and Dangerous thing, because I didn't think I'd ever write that book. And, now I'm more interested in writing than than drumming, really. But luckily I can do both,
The first time
carry on.
Oh, it's okay. Like, I grew up in MTV, 80s, early 80s kid. And the first time I saw Simon was that Pete Townsend solo record,
Yeah.
And, he made an impression just because, wow, this sounds really tight. It's Tony Butler, I think, was in the band on bass.
Yeah.
And, but I didn't, it sounds like a rock band, but I had no idea until years later, how vast his chops were.
Yeah.
I just considered him he's in a cute little rock band and cool songs and everything's simple, but his knowledge was way beyond what I thought. And it took my maturity to understand what the skills he actually had.
That was an incredible drive. Yeah.
Have you ever toured the US in a band?
No, I've never toured. I've only really been to, I went to Ireland for a week to tour with a band called Texas Flood, who were a Stevie Ray Vaughan covers tribute band. And the guy who ran the band was from Ireland, and so he had relatives over there. He put up, so it was like a family, I toured, played some pubs, some nice boozers and stuff, and a couple of clubs. And then I went to France with a band called the Harper Brothers, French Alps, for a couple of weeks, and did loads of gigs there, up and down the mountainsides and all that sort of thing. But no, I've never, other than that, I've never toured anywhere. I've always been a, you know, working man in other other capacities, like a writer in advertising, stuff like that. I've been all sorts, but I've never actually been a professional drummer, ever.
Have you ever been asked to host another show besides yours?
No, I haven't.
TV or cable?
No, I've been told that I should have been. But
yeah. No, you need an agent.
Yes, maybe. I mean, that's a real compliment. You know, I'd love to do that.
Well, I mean, but, like I said, I love my stupid sports, American sports teams, and some of them are just so hard to watch because they can't complete a sentence and they're contradicting themselves constantly, and or just the language, or you know, they include political stuff, and it's just like enough. But your stuff is very easy to watch, and I like your little vignettes, you know, your advertising, advertisements for your book.
Oh, thank you.
You have a good sense of comedy, you know, and it's so you're. Yeah, I definitely, I would get yourself an agent, you know, expand your portfolio.
Yeah, well, I'd love to be a presenter, because I love presenting the, you know, the Mad, Bad, and Dangerous stuff. We stopped doing it a while back. I think we're going to start again in a bit because my nephew wants to do a bit of a more fun take on it. But
yeah,
I'd love to, of course, I'd love to be doing that on TV. That would be lovely to do that. But, you know,
I don't want to keep you forever. As I keep interrupting you, I don't want to keep you forever. I just have a couple more things. Like I said, I have a school here. It's called Loud House, and they're very young kids, but some of them are serious about, you know, if there was a music industry again, playing in bands and stuff like that. So I developed this thing called the Drummer's Tool Belt, where I give them these little coins for achievement, whether it be like counting note values or basic rudiments and things like that, and warming up properly. What would you say, either personally, your suggestion, or from the drummers that you've talked to, would be two or three really important things for a young musician going into any room around the world, even if they can't communicate speaking, they can communicate musically, whether it be something technical or maybe even just having a good attitude, how to work with people, or what do you think is super important? Like Jerry Murata, for instance, he's like, listen, just listening is the most important thing. What would you say?
I would say he's right about the listening thing. But if, I would say, well, I'll tell you this. It sounds a bit mad, but the real way I really learnt rhythm and to play the drums and an appreciation of music was from a very young age. I would rock backwards and forwards in the chairs at home, singing to myself. If there was no music on, I would just sing stuff I liked, and I would rock the rhythm. So it would be, you know, like this sort of thing, you know, the backbeat used to be on that way, but then I changed it to be the front way. I don't know why, but my sisters, I've got three younger sisters, and they do it too. We do this over the years. Then we put music on incredibly loudly, really loudly. So it really upset my parents, but because they'd see us rocking in the chairs, destroying the chairs. I mean, yeah, we did it when we were adults. I mean, we did it in our 20s, you know, before we left home. We would be rocking because we never stopped. So, but the thing is, it made me think about, because it's like going into a kind of a, you know, a meditative state. And I'd listen to all sorts of things like, anything from popular pop music, T-Rex, all sorts of stuff back in the 70s, of Jethro Tull, of Genesis, all sorts of stuff. And we would just literally rock. And we'd do it together. It was like a social thing. But we wouldn't speak. We would just rock. And and quite hard as well. And it did destroy the chairs. I mean, it really did. And you can understand my folks, well, my dad was particularly annoyed that he'd come in and he'd say, stop the rocking. And sometimes we'd hear the door go, and he'd open the door and we'd stop in mid-rock, pretending we weren't rocking. So we'd halfway through like this. We might as well have got up and carried on, said, oh, sorry. And
But so just on vinyl, someone would go over, your sister would put on the record, and you'd all get in the chairs and rock back and forth.
Yeah, yeah, we'd take it into, we had those one of those old 45 things where the records would drop down, you know, we had one of those. And so we'd take it in turns to put on our favorite tracks, our favorite 45s, and we'd sit and we would just rock. And then my sisters formed a dance group because they got the rhythm in them, and then I became a drummer. But we even though after that, we rocked into our late 20s, early 30s, until the people that we married and families that we got involved with, we were worried they might think we were, there's something wrong with it. So we stopped doing it. But I would say, anyway, going back to your question, what you earlier said is, yeah, listen. But maybe listen with movement too, because if you can translate that into your whole body, I don't mean just dancing, because we know what dance does, but actually in a chair, get a chair, sit in the chair and move backwards and forwards to what you're hearing, because you'll hear what's going on in a different way. And close your eyes when you're doing it. Not always. Sometimes my eyes are open, sometimes they're closed. Doesn't matter.
Sounds like just you'd be rocking in a sensory while you're in the
room. In a sensory, yeah, exactly that. So I would say that.
And listen to many genres, as you said, as many as you can.
Absolutely. Every type of music, not just one, just all sorts of music, because you're always going to find something, whatever it is,
that you can
apply to moving backwards and forwards. It's moving backwards and forwards. That's what it's all about. And it's kind of, one, it makes you want to do it because it's a nice thing to do anyway. You know, on the occasions it doesn't send you to sleep, it'll learn something.
You know, yeah. Like,
but no, very, I would say that.
Very soothing.
The three things, believe in yourself and rock backwards and
forwards. I love it. I noticed that I keep seeing the ads for Duff and Guns N' Roses. Their schedule is starting to get packed for next year. Everything's 2022.
You're doing lots at the moment, aren't you, with...
Oh, well, that's not me. I'm in his other band. But
yeah.
I was wondering, like, are shows starting to open up where you are? Yeah. The gigs are coming back.
They are, yeah. I'm going to be playing tomorrow. I'm a percussionist in a band called the Swan Vesta Social Club.
Okay.
Which is a 10-piece Cuban stroke, pop stroke, dance, fun, rock ensemble who are very much interactive with audience, which, of course, is why we couldn't do that, you know. During COVID, but it's a 10-piece, and I'm one of four percussionists in that band, and I do some shaky stuff, and, you know, cabasa and a bit of timbal, and we swap around a lot. Nice. It's great fun, and a lot of the gigs we couldn't do, we're now doing up and down England again, in festivals, and some pubs locally, some boozers, you know, clubs. But they're, you know, some of them are getting nervous and cancelling, but some of them are keeping it open. So we'll see what happens. But my first one is tomorrow, funnily enough, in St. Albans, in a little English pub called The Farmer's Boy, outside. We're going to see how that goes. And we've got one the next day in a place called Castlebury Park, which is in Watford, near where we live. And then the festival ones are all scheduled to start moving up and down the country as you know, as the year goes on. So it is opening up, but it's all a little bit, you know, we're still not getting the go ahead until July 19 now it is, then we're being told that things are going to be lifted completely. But we don't know, you know, whether or not that will really happen. I mean, hopefully it will, but how's things over where you are? Are you able to do the...
I've been seeing ads for some friends' bands in Seattle proper for maybe a couple months from now.
Yeah.
Maybe August-ish. Yeah. I've
seen right. So months. It's a lot more restricted where you are at the moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think so more favorite, frustrating.
Yeah. I think I'm most familiar with the Islington. Is the Garage still there? Are they going to have shows? You're familiar with the Garage at Islington?
I think it is. I haven't been there for a long time.
It's so funny. I went for a walkabout there. I've played there a few times in the neighborhood, and yeah. There was a bar. I think there was a bar right across from the prison entrance that's called Breakout.
That's
funny. Hey, thanks for spending so much time with me.
It's been a pleasure.
You're writing the new book, but for now, people can buy Mad, Bad, and Dangerous at Amazon or anything on
the books. Of course. If, as I say, if you send me your address in the US there, I'll send one to you and sign it to you.
Okay. I appreciate it.
Nice to meet you. Let's do this again.
All right. That was informative. Yeah. You're a good guy. You're really fun.
Thank you. Lovely to be there. I'll
send you a link when this is all, when I edit out all the stupid stuff. The ugly filter, and then I'll send you the polished product.
Nice to meet you.
All right.
In person. Send me your address.
Okay. Bye.